And thank you very much for tuning in via YouTube, the podcast. Love it. You guys actually make it well worth doing.
I decided to get into this realm because I wanted to amplify my voice.
Washington's number one LGBTQ news talk show. Progressive talk, celebrity interviews, and issues that matter most to you. Join us now for the dynamic duo, your hosts, Robert Christian and Drew Griffin.
And welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to hour number two of the Robert Christian Show. We have a special guest, a featured guest today, ladies and gentlemen, that is unmistakable. Somebody that is has been in film, near a television screen near you if you have a DVD player. What is it, Broadway? He has a star on Broadway. We're going to be talking, ladies and gentlemen. Shall I say any more? Charles Bush is going to be joining us. And I love the movie Die Mommy Die. We actually have the DVD from Sundance. We're going to be talking a little bit about it. And he is going to be talking a little bit, maybe, and addressing the question, what on earth did he do with the high heels? Does he still have them? or does he not? And what did it actually take to get him to walk in that sand? So tell us a little bit about that story as we begin, if you want to.
about walking in the sand in spiky heels?
Yes.
It ain't easy. And I don't think I did it very well. Unfortunately, it was a comedy. Because really, as soon as I step, you know, your heel goes way down below. I thought we were going to strike oil if I walked any further.
Well, did they put any a piece of wood under the surface so you could walk on it to keep you upright? Really?
That's a low budget movie, honey. It's an indie. It's each man for himself.
You know, I've got to say, I think that for me, my favorite is Die Mommy Die. I mean, am I that old timey or something to like, hey guys, watch this movie. I mean, I love the movie. I think it's great.
Well, I'm very proud of it. It was just a kind of a miracle. It's so funny how, you know, how often in your life you don't realize how happy you were until it's over. But in this case, the 21 days that we shot that movie, I was just in this kind of state of euphoria. It was so much fun. It was thrilling.
So it took you 3 weeks to do the movie, but you know, it talking about a cult following, that is still one of my top 10 favorites.
Oh, thank you.
You know, and the character that you played, how you did this, you know, like acting like you were just the meanest woman, you know, evil, drinking.
She's not evil. I'm enormously sympathetic for it. Really, you know, it's she's not who she seems, actually. You know, as it turns out, it's the twist. We don't want to give it all away. I don't know whether it matters or not. She's actually her twin sister. You know, she's actually, I've been enormously sympathetic. But you know, I'm sympathetic to monsters.
Is there going to be a remix of this movie anytime in the future?
Like a remake?
Yes.
I better not.
Would you do it, though, if they asked you?
Oh, with me, yes. Yeah, in a second. I'm desperate to be in another movie.
And I know that Jason Priestley was in it. You know, I always thought he was a good-looking little cuss. You know, and
I guess he's kind of a short guy.
Is he really short?
Yeah, kind of. But I'm not that tall either, so sometimes I would just take my shoes off.
Well, I remember meeting Brian Austin Green several years ago, well, many years ago in L.A., and he is not necessarily a tall guy either. You know, and I'm like, oh my gosh, you know. Anyway, that's been years ago. But you know, looking back though at your career, you have an incredible career. Would you do it all over again, Charles?
I really would have no choice, to be honest with you. I wanted, ever since I can remember, I just wanted to be in the theater, or, you know, just to act and to write. So it's funny because it took me until I was about 31 to be able to actually, you know, earn a living doing what I do, and I never for a second wavered. It just wouldn't have even occurred to me. I just, you know, plugged ahead. But I was always encouraged along the route.
You know, my partner and I, Steve, we were talking about you and about this interview last night, and he said, you know what, he would really be very curious to know if, you know, people like John Waters has ever gone to one of your performances there in the city and has seen you. Do you know if he's ever been there?
Oh, yes. I know. I think I sat with him, actually, at a screening of Die Mommy Die in Provincetown. Oh, he's always been very nice to me. I don't know him well, but whenever I go up to Provincetown where he lives, you just always run into him on the street or in a, you know, pizza parlor or a bar, and we always have a lovely, lovely time. The funny thing was that when I was a student, when I was at Northwestern, you know, in college, he came up to host a screening of one of his movies, and the organizer for the program tried to find, you know, the gayest person on campus to sort of keep him company while he was there. And so, of course, you know, I was the gayest person on campus, so they chose me and my roommate. And so we spent about 24 hours squiring him around. And, well, he's just a delightful person. You know, lovely man.
I would love to meet him and meet up with him. I mean, he goes back, and he is one of those directors that Hollywood just never forgets. And yeah. And your character in Die Mommy Die, I mean, that is like one of those unforgettable characters as well, in my opinion.
Oh, thank you.
Am I a little biased for saying that? Maybe I am. But you know, I think it's fantastic. But knowing you know, some of the folks that you have that have come to see you in your plays, do you prefer though film versus live plays?
I actually tell you the truth. See, I've only really made a handful of movies. I had little parts in a couple big movies, and then these basically three indie films. So, but I love it. I think I've actually preferred acting in film, but really my career has been in the theater, and that's marvelous too, but the experiences I've had in film really just were kind of overwhelming.
We were talking, Steve and I were talking, and he brought up the fact, he said, you know what, this is what I think is what happened with Charles, is that there was a theater group years ago that you were involved in, and they did not have enough actors, or nobody showed up or something, and you were there, and you were like, let the show go on, and you more or less had saved the theater. What was that?
I don't know. Are you sure that's me?
Yeah, that's what he said. And I was like, really? You know, because, you know, I know that some people do get stage fright. I used to get stage fright bad, real bad. Yeah. But, oh, Lord, yes. But not anymore. People can't hardly shut me up. But, you know.
It's the opposite, actually. I didn't start really getting stage fright. Or it's more like stage anxiety more than fright. I didn't start getting that until about 7 years ago. Way, way late in my career, suddenly I just started getting this terrible anxiety, and it was like I was about to go to the electric chair, and I would just be thinking, oh, in the dressing room, in 2 hours, it'll all be over. It was terrible, but I've kind of gotten out of that for the most part now, mainly because for about 5 years now, I've had a whole new career as a cabaret concert performer, traveling all over. I've been to about 25 cities, and here and in Europe. And oddly enough, that kind of has cured me from the stage fright. Somehow it's the intimacy and actually being myself when I'm doing my act and really relating to people. And Yeah, I don't know. It's an odd thing, but it seems to have ebbed. But for a couple of years there, it was really kind of awful. Almost every night, you'd think, why am I putting myself through this? Just sort of nauseated feeling. It's not fun. But then it would go away. As soon as you go on stage, it would go away, and I'd have a great time.
But you enjoy the work, though, in itself, the drama, I guess. Not everybody, I've got to say, not everybody can pull off the drama and comic routines the way that you do. In the movie that I saw, the Die Mommy Die movie, yes, it was very funny in places, but it was very dramatic in others, and it would leave the audience exactly where you wanted them, on the edge of their seat, like, what's going to happen next?
Well, thank you. Well, it sounded like that. There are many different kinds of kind of campy movie parody type plays or movies, and they're all very have their own style. And I guess my style is the fact that I'm something of a film historian. You know, I really know these movies, and I love them so much that my plays that are based on films, or my movies that are based on plays that are based on films, are sometimes so close to the actual movie that they can actually be enjoyed as the old movie, if that makes any sense to you.
Yes.
And so I love the roller coaster of tone. I like going for a big laugh and then suddenly having it get very dramatic and then go for the laugh again. Now, I love that. For me, I enjoy that more than just all one-note silliness. That's just my taste.
Well, there was, there is a lot of laughter in the movie, a lot of very seriousness in the movie, a lot of drama. I mean, the way that it was all played out, start to end, and it made you feel, unusually good at the end of the movie, I think. Trust me, we have the movie. I adore the movie, and I adored you in it. Fantastic. But looking at your career, Charles, what would you tell somebody that is young and upcoming in the theater or in acting? What would you tell them as far as to encourage them maybe to keep going, or, hey, don't do this. You really don't want this life.
Well, I don't think anybody should be discouraged. And I used to think, oh, gee, at a certain point, if it's not working out for you, maybe you should wise up. But I don't think that's right either. Just, you never know. Like, there was a play of mine that was on Broadway, my one big Broadway hit called The Tale of the Allergist's Wife. And there was a part of the old mother in it. And we cast this wonderful actress, Cheryl Bernheim, who was 80 years old. And she'd had a very undistinguished career. And so she had to basically wait till she was 80 years old to get this big part on Broadway, and she was fabulous. And, so I guess I'm glad somebody didn't tell her at the age of 70, oh, honey, better cool it. You never know.
Well, have you made appearances like on The Tonight Show or what is the Late Night Show? What is his name? Oh, my goodness. He's there in the city, right on Broadway.
Jimmy Fallon.
Fallon, yes, Fallon, Colbert.
No, I haven't. No, they don't really, on late night TV, they don't really have people from the theater. Only a couple times, I think Nathan Lane gets on, and, I'm not sure, very few. They don't really, basically there's not much interest in the theater anymore. It's become, I think it's thought of as a rather elite thing, and so they don't put us on television.
I mean, looking back, if you remember George Burns and Gracie Allen, decade, that generation on television back then, their big thing was either going to a movie or going to the theater. They had this big thing about going to a theater to see a live performance. I've been to a couple of live performances in a theater, and I think it's kind of cool the way that it's put together. But it gives you a way different feel than something that is taped and there it is. I mean, the way it is. If it's going to mess up, it's really going to happen when you're doing it live, right?
really, the theater is kind of an essential part of humanity. I mean, people are watching live performances and you know, when they were cavemen. You know, it's always been. It's always storytelling. It stems from storytelling, and people like to hear a story. And there is something about seeing it live that has its own magic.
So I mean, I can totally understand and comprehend somebody think, you know, hey, I'd rather do it live and in front of a live audience, because you sort of feed off of the energy, don't you, from the audience?
Yes, it's like at its best, it's almost like walking a tightrope, where you know you're just playing with the audience and to elicit these responses from them, and when you, it's so lovely the kind of give and take and giving out and then receiving back. And just the technical aspect of comedy you have to be skilled, because, you know, you get, let's say you're lucky enough to get the laugh, and then you have to know just when to come in for your next line. If you come in too soon, the audience won't hear your line. If you wait too long, it gets kind of dead. The balloon is, the air went out. You know, it takes enormous skill and practice, and then and talent. You know, you kind of really can't teach anybody how to really be funny. I mean, you can get people to refine their skills and really learn. But
Joan Rivers was really into the theater in New York. Did you ever meet Joan Rivers?
What about her?
She was into the theater scene in New York. Did you ever meet her?
Oh, she was a very dear friend of mine. Actually, I think this would have been her birthday today.
Are you serious?
I think so. Yeah. No, she was a very, very dear friend of mine, and I miss her so much. She was everything that you thought she'd be, and a lot more. And that's another case of somebody who was very funny in life. Just, you know, just in a room, she was, you know, a very witty woman. But
yes,
she also wasn't relentlessly on. It was kind of people wouldn't really think that she was a rare celebrity that didn't sort of take up all the air in the room. She was genuinely interested in other people. That was the thing that was so rather surprising and so just beautiful about her, is that she really was interested in you and wanted to give you the focus. And then at the same time, when it was her turn, I mean, she was just so funny. You know, I spent every Thanksgiving with her, and she was at my house at Christmas. And we were great friends.
Well, as I remember, she did something for an HIV and AIDS group there in the city, with some sort of a food program they had. Were you involved in that at all?
No, but she was a great supporter. It's called God's Love Me Deliver.
That's it. That's it.
Oh, she had a funny line, though, because she had done it for years. You know, I believe she was actually the very first celebrity to be involved in an AIDS fundraiser. And she really, you know, was very active. But she used to say that she started delivering, you know, food to, you know, people with AIDS very early on. And then a few years ago, you know, when things had calmed down a bit, she said she went over to some guy's house to give him the, you know, serve him his dinner, and he said, just leave it on the desk. I'm going off to the gym." so okay.
Well, I think that within some of her comic and comedy routine, she would take maybe some of these little things that people would say and build a huge storyline about it and get some of the biggest laughs.
Yeah.
But she, you know, I think that she was a very caring woman, and you know, the world, I think, misses her greatly.
Yes, no, she's fascinating and just a wonderful, magical part of my life. It's still hard for me to believe that she's not around. I keep hoping it's like a big prank that suddenly she'll appear and that she fooled all of us.
You know, I think that if she were around now, she'd probably come knocking on your door and telling you to snap to, you know, get with the program. You know, what took you so long? But you know, she seemed, you know, on television and in the theater setting in her routines coast to coast where she was going for her own performances. You know, she was completely out of the box. And you don't find that very often with big name celebrities. What's up with that?
Well, she was, it was kind of remarkable that a woman, all the way after 80, who stayed so relevant. And I remember I used to go to the theater with her. She loved going to the theater, and she saw at least one play every week. I mean, she saw everything. That's how I got to know her, because she came to every play I ever did, and then we became friends. But I'm kind of losing my train of thought here. But I remember the last time I went to a play with her, not long before she died. And you know, I think it was Orlando Bloom, the movie star, was doing Romeo and Juliet on Broadway. And during intermission, my God, it seemed like she was the star. They were just young, and it was basically young girls, because a lot of young people wanted to see Orlando Bloom. And they all were lined up down the aisle, all wanting to take a picture with Joan Rivers. I thought that was pretty amazing for an 81-year-old lady.
You know, she always kept her audience. She kept she captivated their attention, and people they looked at her like, you know, no matter how old she's almost like Cher, in that, because here's Cher, she's up in age too, but when she starts singing, she can belt it out and she can bring a house down.
She was incredible at the Billboard Awards.
Oh Lord, have you ever met her, Cher?
No, I have not.
Really? Have not. All right, Cher, get with it.
She's supposed to be just the most fun and basic and unpretentious person.
You know, I think it's divine. You know, when I reach out to some celebrities, and they do reach back, because, you know, I like to hear their stories and to hear something from them, something that changed their life forever, or maybe how that they have been a token to help to change somebody else's life and their visions and aspirations. Do you find that people look at you as maybe as their mentor?
Well, you know, it's so funny. You know, we go about our own lives and have our own, you know, insecurities and depressions and doubts and all that, and then it's so lovely when you do, you know, get a letter or you meet somebody after a show or on Facebook, or you know, and people say, oh, you meant something. And you know, I was doing my one of my shows, cabaret shows, where was I, in Colorado or something, and afterwards a young woman came up to me and she said, oh, and I have to tell you, Mr. Bush, when I was 14 years old, I saw a copy of your collected plays in the library, and I stole it, and I loved it so much, it made me want to be a writer, and I vowed that someday I would have a theater company like yours devoted to schlock. Oh, thank you, dear. Thank you. She I knew what she meant. It came out a little funny. So yeah, no, it's lovely. I didn't really get it as much as now that I'm traveling so much. Now that I've really been in all these places, and part of what I like to do when I do my shows is, as soon as the play is over, or not play, as soon as my act is over, I go right into the audience and I chat with everybody and take pictures of everyone, and it's been really wonderful for me. To get to talk to people who maybe never seen me live and only knew me for these couple little movies of mine or read my plays or seen. A lot of people know me because their local theater companies will do my plays and they've never actually seen me. So it's been enormously fulfilling and kind of affirming to me to meet people and to like to know. Listen, you know, who wouldn't want to know that gee, you know, your life was worth it, that you made an impression, that you helped somebody come out because of being in one of your plays, or seeing one of your shows gave somebody a glimpse of greater freedom or something that's a little magical, that's a little bigger than life. When that happens, I'm so proud of it. It's really helped me a lot.
You know, I don't think I don't think that there is enough celebrities that reach out to their audience the way that you do, and you two, you captivate people. I mean, I don't know about you, but I've been in places where as soon as somebody walked into the room, it's like all the oxygen just suddenly went to that person, and everybody else is left gasping. You know, I don't see you as one of those kind of people either, but somebody that does reach out, and you want to know what the audience or what your fans are feeling. But how important is that to you, to know how that they're feeling during your performances?
If you mean, I certainly like getting the emotional response from them while they're watching. You don't want a dead house. You want
right.
Nothing. It's a marvelous moment, too. I must say, I love it, particularly when I'm singing, because I do so much singing now with my act. As much as getting the big laugh is marvelous, there's a wonderful satisfaction when the audience is so quiet and then nobody's moving a muscle, and you can just, and they're just so wrapped, and you can walk a different kind of tightrope of just feeling quiet emotion. That's a wonderful feeling too, to get from an audience.
So it's really a good feedback, I guess, in a spiritual realm, sort of, as to what the audience is doing. Is that right?
Yes, there is something, I guess, in a way, spiritual about it, just because it's human beings communing. You know, I'm giving to you, and you're giving back to me. There's something very, you know, in its purest form, it's very, very beautiful.
You know, I'm like a lot of people when they look at new movies coming out or new theater shows coming out, and they're like, you know, I will go see this because I like the actor, or I am not going to see that movie because I don't like the actors in it. Mm-hmm. You know, but when people are drawn to you, it's sort of kind of a strange feeling, is it not? Because even with you, Charles. You know, after, so many years after Die Mommy Die was done, canned, and released, and here you are still in the theaters and still exploring who the real you is. Mm-hmm. I think in every performance. Is that not right?
Well, yes. I mean, if I wasn't, then I should retire.
Canned, dead.
Thing, which some, you know, and then some actors happen. They lose that spark. They lose that connection, and that's a terrible tragedy when that happens. Fortunately, it hasn't happened to me yet. I hope it doesn't. If I really did feel that somehow, I don't know, I was walking through it and just not really experiencing it, then I think that I would like to think that I'd be wise enough to just be a writer, you know, and not be putting myself out there. But I'm loving more than anything. I don't want to come off like I'm some big sappier, but this whole new singing cabaret thing I'm doing is so special to me because I'm not playing a role, because, you know, in all my movies or plays, I'm Charles Bush playing a specific character. But when I do my act, it's very close approximation of who I really am. I mean, it really is who I am, maybe dialed up a tad. And even the act of singing, you know, when you somehow melody itself, there's something pure about it, just expressing in the moment this emotion to the audience. I'm feeling actually more kind of connected than maybe I ever have with an audience.
Would you think, though, that you know, of course, people are people, audiences are audiences, but do you think that the West Coast audiences are different vibrations, I guess, than the East Coast?
Well, listen, I've never played at the Pacific Northwest. I've never played there, but I've performed a lot in California, all way across. In fact, last March, I did a rather extensive tour throughout California, and I've done a number of plays for you know, nice run in Los Angeles. I love it. I am not one of those New York LA bashers. Now, mind you, I've only been in L.A. to do an exciting thing, making a movie or being in a play. And so it's fine. I've never been looking for work. But that's not fun in any city. I don't think I'd like to be in Tuscaloosa and looking for work. But in L.A., I surely wouldn't like that. But I love performing in L.A. I find the audiences almost my best audiences in Los Angeles. They're all from New York originally, and so many of them are showbiz connected. They really get me. No, I love it. I can't wait to go back.
Well, if you really like slapstick comedy in a movie, Del Shores, I don't know if you know Del. But he has the new movie out that they're doing the premieres upcoming, I believe, in New York. What is it? A Very Sordid Wedding. Very funny, outlandish show. But it was based on what had happened 20 years ago. And that's one reason why that I'd asked you, would there be a sequel coming out anytime soon to Die, Mommy, Die?
Well, there's nothing to talk about. But oddly enough, Del Shores and I are seriously talking about working together.
Really?
I hope that happens soon. We're working on the idea for a project.
We've had him on the show, Dr. Eve, the doctor that played the psychiatrist for Brother Boy on the original shows. She was a guest on the show here recently. I look at what Del is doing, and he's bringing a lot of comic relief, I think, to America. And what you're doing and what you've done in a lot of your performances, being the drama being able to bring people, but not everybody can do that, is to bring people from being outrageously mad to outrageously happy. I think that you have that talent.
Thank you.
How do you do that? I mean, I'm kind of oblivious.
I don't know. I wish I could give you an answer to it I think as a writer, I write my own plays, and acting them. I think I share a lot of the same interests that my audience does. Mm. And then in my plays and movies, and even my act in a way, it's not enough for me just to be kind of campy and outrageous. I every play I've written, well, on one hand, you could say, oh, it's a spoof mm-hmm. of beach party movies. In my heart, there's always more to it. There's something, not really a message, but there's something to say about the human condition.
Yes.
And Die, Mommy, Die, if you take away the melodrama and all the outrageous things that her trying to kill her husband, the essential story really is about a woman who's raised her dead sister's children and wants them to love her. That's really that's the essential thing, and that strikes certain kind of key emotions in people. And then you overlay that with all sorts of movie references, and it's bigger than life, and all that. But there's an essential core of real emotion going on, and I think I like to think that's what's kind of anchoring everything, and that my audience, I hope they like me for the right reasons. Sometimes people can like you for the wrong reasons, but I guess that's okay too, as long as they like you.
I think word of mouth goes a long way, and especially in this day and age. And your performances, what you do, you put everything that you have into each of them. I know that you have to. And you can only go so far, but sooner or later, the real you does come out, and you're like, and now I'm a little bit more relaxed because the character that maybe that you're playing, that you add a little bit more of yourself into it. Yeah. Isn't that what Jason Priestley had said about his character, in Die, Mommy, Die?
It's an interesting thing. Once in a while, we were doing a revival of a play of mine that we had done a couple of years ago called The Divine Sister, and we were doing it out of town, and it was kind of an older community, and I don't think they really were getting it so much for it. They didn't think it was so funny, and so rather than trying to push to try to, you know, get broader to get a laugh, we just got more real. And since they're kind of comic melodramas in a certain sense, they're very intense stories, we just started playing it for drama. And it worked very well. I had a wonderful time just playing it like I was doing, you know, Arthur Miller. And then the last weekend, suddenly all the queens from New York showed up, and we were sold out, and they were screaming of laughter. And I thought, why are they laughing at my beautiful, serious play? I'd gotten used to getting no laughs. So, you know, now, I think that, like I said, just you have to have a core of reality to everything. Any kind of silliness, I think, is better when it's grounded in some kind of real emotion.
You know, I want to focus just a minute or two, because here we are in June, and this is Pride Month, as you know, around the country. But, you know, a lot of the festivities, a lot of the things that you see at Pride Parade are so outlandish. But a lot of the population of America, they look at the gay and the lesbian community like, oh, my God, here they come dressed up like this. And they want us to take them seriously. What's really the matter with that picture?
Honestly, you can't live for other people.
Right.
People who are, you know, have some kind of homophobia or what, they're not going to like you whatever you do. They didn't like us when we were, they condemned us when we were promiscuous. Then we want to get married. They don't like that either. They would just like us to go away, basically. And so you can't try to tampen your high spirits to somehow get some homophobic person to like you. I think people just have to be free to be who they are. And yes, I mean, some people are, I'm sure, turned off by and are convinced that gay people are all, you know, lesbians with pierced nipples, you know, and drag queens, you know, with big huge tits, you know, it's all breath.
Yes.
But, you know, I mean, what are you going to do? I certainly would not like to see anybody censored and told, you know, on their day of celebration, ooh, no, don't do that. I believe that in the early days of the New York Gay Pride celebrations, that there was a terrible conflict between the drag queens and transgender people who were so involved in the Stonewall riot and were suddenly not the right image for the new gay politics. And it was a very tense showdown, I think, in those first parades and all that. But, you know, I don't think you should temper yourself.
Now, when you were younger, were you ever able to go to Studio 54?
No, when 54... Studio 54 was around. I was very poor. I was just out of college, I guess, and just starting a career, and I was broke. I could never have gone. I was never there. It sounds like just such a kind of fascinating period. Now I've missed that. But I never really was a club person at all. I was so driven to succeed in the theater. That was all. I really was kind of obnoxious, to be quite honest. Some of the older men that I would date, you know, I think they just finally all ditched me because they just thought I was obnoxious. Just, you know, every time they take me to a play, I think that ought to be me up there. I was just one track thing. So the idea of going to, even if I had the money, I don't think I would have gone to clubs because, you know, I don't really drink and I never took drugs. My drug was being on stage. That's what I wanted.
You know, I can sort of identify with you because, I mean, as a kid, back when I was a little kid, you know, I always had said that I wanted one of these days, and when I grew up, I wanted to be the man in the radio. You know, that's who I wanted to be, was the little man in the radio. Thinking, that hey, that will work, that's me. But needless to say, I was a geek back then, well, sort of a nerd, and I would tear radios apart and put them back together to figure out how they worked. And I was successful. And sometimes I'd walk away with a few screws that I had no idea where they came from. But anyway, it worked. But, you know, I always looked at media, and as a kid, Not like, you know, I really want to do this, but I think media chose me. Do you feel that way about acting?
Oh, yes. There was just no, it wasn't a choice to be made. And it's funny because sometimes now I'm at a certain point kind of in my life where, or at least a couple of years ago, where I was suddenly questioning every choice that I had made and thinking, what, you know, did I make the wrong detour? Or should I have chosen that? And at a certain point, it becomes a needless rumination. Where the hell is it going to get you? And ultimately, I kept thinking, well, no. I mean, it wasn't a choice. This is what I wanted to do, and I didn't want it. And don't get jealous of somebody else's success, because that's not. I didn't want that in the first place. So, you know, you get all sorts of crazy notions at different points of your life. They're different turning points in all of our lives. So, from childhood on, certain key years and of questioning and confusion, and hopefully you get through them and until you get to the next turning point. Yeah, no, I had no, there was nothing else I could have done. I wouldn't have done, I think I wouldn't have done anything differently. A couple things I would have tried to be a little more diplomatic about. I think maybe there are a couple times when I've hurt people's feelings, I wish that I had been more diplomatic and a little more sensitive. But I probably would have done the same thing again. Just hopefully I would have handled it better.
You know, I've always said, Charles, that it's perfectly normal because, look, we're human beings. It's normal to make a mistake, and that's all right. We can adapt to that. We can learn and go on. But it's never okay to make a mistake and never learn anything from it. We have to continue to learn, to continue to grow. And you are in such a vital position, Charles, right now, I think.
I'm in a very good place right now. I'd say about a year ago, a year and a half ago, I wasn't in such a good place. I was kind of going through one of those, you know, those periods in life where you just start doubting yourself and questioning. But right now, I'm in a very good place. I'm ready for the third act, honey.
You know,
I'm ready for something big to happen.
Charles, if I can, if I must, I will admit it. I've been there too, thinking, you know what? Wait a second. I'm giving my all, 60 to 80 hours a week, something like that on average, start to finish, that I put into each show that I do, each podcast, to make sure that it is as right as I possibly can make it. Reaching out, doing the PR, the guests, the booking, all this stuff. But you know what? Sooner or later, it does begin to start coming back home. And to me, that is what makes it so well worth it.
Mm-hmm. Oh yeah. No, I'm enjoying. I'm really in a good, very lovely place now, I can say. Yeah, because I'm enjoying my work. I'm getting a lot of new ideas and get to be on your show. I just I'm in a good place.
Now what? Let's fast forward just about 20-25 years. Charles, what are you going to be doing in your retirement?
I don't know if I'll retire. Honestly, as long as people want to see me, I'll probably be doing something, I would think.
That's the mark of a legend, if I can say so myself. You are kind of legendary. You know this, right?
I'm a very peculiar kind of fame. I mean a great deal to some people, and I'm completely unknown to many. It's I think a big test, if you're a test for being a real big star, is if everybody's mother has heard of you, then you're famous. But most people's mothers have not heard of you.
Well, I'm nowhere near a star. But I'm like almost famous, just almost. But you know, it's not necessarily that I'm trying to, or that I want to build a name for myself, or my brand, my product. Try this product. You know, I'm not necessarily about that. But you know, I I remember back what Larry King had said, and for me, he was a mentor. And Larry, he said, you know what? In order to look good, your guests have to look good. And I like to always bring that into focus with everything that I do when it comes to the shows, because if I don't give the guest enough leeway, enough latitude to be able to cover a lot of bases and go with the flow, but I keep them kind of concealed into a little bitty box, it never works.
Yeah, so there are some people, you know, when you go on their show, it really is all about them and them trying to be clever, and it's, you know, you just have, they don't really bring, they're not really that interested in the guest, and you know, you have to kind of work to, you know, put yourself across. But it's, you're a lovely interviewer. Thank you for having me.
You know, Charles, I am. You know what? This is the, can I be frank? Can I be honest with you? This is almost, well, it is. Okay, I just lied. It is the first time, really, on a live show that I have been starstruck, if that's the word,
really?
Since many years ago when I had the honor, the opportunity. And it wasn't but maybe 5 minutes, but I'll never forget it, interviewing Phyllis Diller years ago.
Was she wonderful?
Oh, my God.
I knew her a bit. She used to come to my shows. And
she was outlandish. Charles, here it was, a Hollywood, what was it, the Christmas party, the Christmas parade, you know, but in Hollywood, well, everybody knows it doesn't snow in Hollywood, so they bring in this, anyway, it's a disaster when they're done, but I saw her, I was walking around the corner, there she was in a car, and she flipped her boa thing over her shoulder, and she says, "It's okay, darling." But just the way that she went off in the conversation to immediately capture the attention, you know, to me that always struck in my head.
I learned an interesting lesson from watching her. She had not performed in New York for many, many years. Vegas really was her thing, and she was used to playing those enormous showrooms. And
yes.
The wigs and crazy headdresses and those wild Mylar costumes. And then she came back to New York and performed in this very intimate, rather elegant room. And evidently the first night, she came out there in the crazy wig and the crazy costume, and it was terrible. And she didn't get any laughs, and it was kind of a bit of a disaster. And then I was there the second night, and she changed the entire thing. She came out in just a simple black dress with just very nice hairdo and I think the diamond earrings, and it was so fascinating, and she was brilliant, and it reminded me, I felt like I was seeing her like in the early 60s when she was first starting out, and I thought that, and I'd heard, and I knew the publicist, and he filled me in on what had happened the night before. And I thought, wow, isn't that interesting that here she is, this, you know, true comedy legend,
yes,
institution, and yet she's reinventing herself overnight, figuring out what worked, that didn't work, I'll try something different, and taking those risks. And I thought, wow, that's, you know, that's somebody to emulate.
Well, she was definitely one of those individuals that would try something at least once. If it worked, great. If it didn't, okay, ditch it, go on. But that was very, very much like Joan Rivers.
And they both, there were other, the other thing that were a little bit similar about them. Now, I really did not know Phyllis Diller other than when she would come to my shows and we would chat afterwards. But she had known, both actually in real life were rather elegant ladies. You know, they on stage we could get very, you know, broad and vulgar, but they were essentially rather elegant women. Yeah.
You know, Charles, like I say, I'm almost like starstruck, because I have not found ever have I interviewed anybody that had that same type of a draw and a spiritual, I guess, connection and draw, the way that Phyllis had until now. you. And to me, it's amazing. You know, I can't say that I drew a lot from Phyllis. I didn't have time. Literally, I was around the corner. There her car was, and that was it. And just around the corner where I came from, Brian Austin Green, his car, his convertible car, like a 50s whatever, Thunderbird. Anyway, it quit. You know, it just quit running. And here he was stranded, and Phyllis Diller was just a few cars behind him. And I was like, oh, my God. So that's how I ran into her. But it was very impromptu. But, you know, you see screen legends. You see them in movies. You see them live in person, you know, on the stage like what you do in the theater. And I really hope, as far as the population visiting theater, maybe for the first time, that they too will fall in love with it and maybe be able to explore the opportunity maybe for them to act in theater. Would you agree to that?
Oh, yes. Well, you know, there's the theater in New York right now is rather exciting period. They're also new playwrights on Broadway and off Broadway, and women writers are getting some more exposure, and women directors, and we have a couple of big, huge hit musicals on Broadway now that are rather adventurous too. Dear Evan Hansen and Come From Away, and it's a good period.
So
right now in New York,
are you doing Broadway shows right now presently?
No, I'm in the midst of writing a play, and I don't know when it's going to be actually done, but I'm working on that. I've got a bunch of things I'm working on. I'm working on a book, and there are a couple of movies that I'm hoping we get made. It's very difficult with even a low-budget independent film. It's not easy to happen. I was very spoiled with the few movies I made. They kind of fell in my lap, basically, Psycho Beach Party and Die, Mommy, Die. It was rather very untypical situations where people saw the play, wanted to make a movie, and we did it. But it's otherwise, just starting from scratch, it's hard, you know. And so there are a couple of projects I have going, and it changes week by week. 1 week, it seems like, oh my gosh, we're going to be making this movie in, you know, 3 months. And then suddenly the next week, oh, no, it's not going to happen. And then the next week, oh, it's going to happen. So it's a bit frustrating, but I ain't giving up.
Well, Charles, no, I don't want you to give up either. One last question, Charles, for you. You know, I've been sort of sitting on this, waiting for the right time. But I guess there is no really right time. But within your careers, within the movies that you've done, and what you've done on Broadway and elsewhere around the country and the globe for that matter, does it hurt your feelings when people talk about past movies that you've done, like Die, Mommy, Die, or does that kind of like turn a light on in your head, like, ah, yes, I remember that.
I love it. But, you know, when you're proud of your work, why wouldn't you want people to tell you that they admire it? Oh my gosh, it'd be terrible if you nobody gave it.
Well, you know,
I like reminiscing. I've got a million stories to tell, and I love going back and
I think the reason why that I asked Charles,
your memory gets jogged and you think of details that you've forgotten. Oh yeah, that's what happened. Or you also have some new perspective as you get older maybe that wasn't quite exactly the way it was. That's what really happened.
Well, you know, the LGBT community, we don't get older, we just get more fabulous.
I hope so.
Hey, you can use that. No worry. You can coin it. I'll just give you the idea. But, you know, I think that you've done fantastic work, most definitely, and in your career. I've been following it, and you know, actually, Steve watched Die Mommy Die yesterday for the first time in a while on the computer, and he was like, "Yeah, you know what? That was really a very good, very well put out, put together movie."
The director, Mark Rucker, he was a very, very respected West Coast theater director. And it was his first only film. And he died a few years ago, very young, tragically. But he was marvelous to work with, and he was so organized. It was his first film. You would have thought that he'd made a dozen movies. He was so organized. You know, in a little indie film like that, which is so low budget, you have to work very quickly, and you really can't get more than one or two takes on a scene. You have to keep moving. It's 21 days. You have to make the whole movie. But he was so in sync with the young woman, Kelly. I can't remember her last name at the moment. You know, it's been 15 years or so. Who was the cinematographer, the DP. They were so in sync that we just moved through scenes, and we shot more than was scheduled, which is unbelievable.
Wow.
And he was great. I just wish that we'd had a chance to work together again, because I admired him so.
Well, you know, Charles, you bring back a lot of memories as far as my time in the city when I used to live there, and I can only miss it for one thing. That's the pizza. I love New York pizza. you know, the Sicilian pizza. I mean, that's to die for almost.
Well, what do you have, like, that in Seattle? Do you have like that kind of Chicago deep dish pizza? Is that what you have?
Well, they have that, like, here, you know, but typically we'll just order out maybe to Pizza Hut, something like that, and be done. But as far as a specialty pizza, I mean, like New York pizza, Chicago, you know, they have their different flavors and their different way of cooking it. I still prefer the New York pizza, though, myself.
Yeah. Well, I grew up on it, so it's what I know best. But New York is, you know, one of the great food cities of the world.
You know, I lived in a place, right on Myrtle Avenue there in Queens for quite some time, above a bakery, of all places. And to me, that was awesome. The landlord, I'll never forget her. She owned Glendale Bakeries back in the day, is what the name of it was. I don't know if you know the bakery, but fantastic place. But I kind of miss it for the pizza.
New York is just filled with sort of secret places that only the people in that neighborhood really know about.
No doubt about it. Well, Charles, listen, hey, it has been a great honor to have you on. And, you know, I did want to thank you for bringing back some good memories of my time there. But focusing it on you and your life and your own success, to me, that's divine.
Well, thank you. I've had a lovely time, and now after we get off the air, I've got to put my whole apartment back together again. If you could see what really is going on here, me trying to make flattering lighting. It's crazy. I moved a lamp from another room and put it above the camera, and I put a pink scarf over it, and I've got all these little extension cords going around. It's crazy. For you.
Oh, well, thank you, Charles. I mean, I love you dearly for it, but you didn't have to go through all that. I mean, you know,
I didn't want to look like some old hag.
You know what? I look like an old hag. I need to do something, though, about getting a wig, I think. Now people are going to be laughing, but I do. I mean, seriously, because my hair, if I'm standing in front of a green screen, my hair kind of goes green and looks like fire going, ooh, and it looks god-awful.
Well, there's always something to do,
Miss Clairol. Anyway, Charles, say, listen, it has been a joy speaking with you, and I will send you the link to the video and of course to the podcast, so you can listen to it later and laugh if you want to, or like, oh my God, I can't believe I just said that.
It's been a real pleasure.
Okay. All right. Thanks so much, Charles, and good luck in the future. And, hey, I'd like to have you back on again, and let me know how things go with you and Del Shores.
Okay. I sure will.
All right. God bless. Good speed. Wow, ladies and gentlemen, an awesome interview. I must absolutely admit, having Charles Bush on, what a fantastic guy. Love it. And the movie, by the way, if you haven't seen it yet, yes, I hope that you all will. It's a movie called Die, Mommy, Die. Ooh, see, look. See, there. For those of you that cannot see this, you shame on you guys. See, it's Sundance. There's Die, Mommy, Die. I love this movie. I absolutely do. Very, very funny. Cutting edge for its day. Yes, it is. All right, folks, I'm Robert Christian. You guys have a dandy one, right? And we'll catch you all next time right here on The Robert Christian Show. So long for now. Of any time for America to stand up and to be counted, of any time for our communities to stand up and be counted, it is today.